Hi, I'm Lokesh Verma and I'm a tattoo artist from New Delhi. Now, most of you must have heard these lines a lot. Own yourself. Own your actions. Take responsibility. Take control of your life. But in reality, a lot of young children, which I have seen, is they are not able to own up to their actions and do what they really want to do because they are met with resistance mostly from their parents. If they want to do something, career options are usually forced on them and they end up doing what they really don't want to do. And these young people end up doing what they're really not interested in, and they might force their dreams and ambitions on their children. And this vicious circle keeps on going, especially in a conservative country like ours and a lot of other places. But fortunately for me, that was not the case. My parents were very supportive in whatever I wanted to do, and in a few instances that they were not, I was rebellious enough not to listen to them at all. So just to give you a quick backstory about me and my family, my father is a retired army man and my mother was an ex-teacher. And after my father retired from the army, we used to live in a small one-room apartment. In fact, the kitchen was also in the same room, and my mother used to give tuitions to 20 children and used to charge 100 rupees per child to earn those extra 2,000 rupees in a month. My father used to do small-time jobs, mostly in security, after retiring. And me and my sister and my parents, four of us, used to live in this one small apartment. And that was very normal for us. And this is, I'm talking about when I was probably 9 or 10 years old. And but we did not feel that, you know, we are lacking something, because we had not seen anything better. Supposedly, if a child, just imagine, if someone is born in a jail, in those four walls, those four walls are very normal for him because he does not know what is outside. So that was our world. We were happy, you know, that those four walls cannot make that child sad. So we were as happy as any child could be. But as I grew up, I came to know that times are difficult, and you know, my father, I did not used to see them 2 or 3 days. Saturdays or Sundays he used to do overtimes. I used to go on my bicycle. In fact, it was not even my bicycle, it was my sister's bicycle. We had only one lady's bicycle, and I was teased for that bicycle a lot. So I used to ride that bicycle, go deliver lunch to him wherever he used to work, in like, you know, big companies and posh colonies. I used to see all these big houses, and I was like, yeah, wow. Then I got exposed to a little bit of outer world, and I wanted to, you know, be a part of it. I was like, wow, I would like to own a house like this someday or do better. But due to lack of resources and toys, when I was a small child, I had only one accessory lying around with me, which was the pencil. So I always used to sketch and draw a lot. In fact, my earliest childhood memory is when I was 7 or 8 years old. And there was this soft drink called 7-Up, and they had a cartoon called Fido Dido. I used to draw that in different positions everywhere, on the back of my notebook, on my school desk, on my bag, my bench partner's bag, whatever I could get my hands onto. So that's where I started to draw. And my teachers recognized I could draw a little bit. So when I was 14, my paintings were sent to Japan by my school, Inter-Asia competition, and they were selected in the first round itself. So I was very happy. But I did not know not anything after that what to do about it, because painting is or drawing or sketching is not a career, mostly in our country or a lot of places like that. So then I forgot about it. But I was very inquisitive and curious about everything new, not only drawing or painting, because mostly because of lack of resources, I wanted to try out everything new, and I was never scared of trying out anything new. And also because the area that I used to live into, it was an unauthorized colony in Delhi in the early 90s, where electricity did not used to be there at all most of the times. We are the actual children who you might have heard of, who have studied under kerosene lamps. Water used to be drawn out of hand pumps, and that was basically it. So, excuse me. So, the day I did not pursue painting as my career, because as everyone told me, this is not an option. So I did my schooling, and the very first day I passed out of my school. In fact, I did not pass out of the school. I just gave my final board exams And the very next day, I took up my very first job. I was 17. In fact, few months short of 17 that time. So I was 16 or some months. And my very first job was to distribute pamphlets on the road. And they were paying me 100 or 200 rupees a day, which was like a big deal for me. Because when I was in school, I used to get 100 rupees pocket money from my parents every month. End of the year, I used to give them 12 notes, 100 rupee notes back to them because I needed it, because I knew that they needed it more than me. So I was earning 100 or 200 a day, which was a big deal for me. Our second job I did was selling dial-up internet connection CDs. So we had a canopy set up in South Campus somewhere, and we had to sell dial-up internet connection CDs. And we were approaching every person on the road, our team of 6 to 8 people. We were approaching every person which we could see, and we were trying to sell these CDs to them. 4 o'clock in the evening, we had not sold anything, and we would not get paid because this was based on the target. So we would not get paid. So then I used my mind a little bit, and I took all my CDs, my part of the CDs that I had to sell, to an internet cafe, because internet cafes were a big rage that time, 30 rupees per hour. So I took all my CDs there, and I spoke to the internet cafe guy, and he bought most of my CDs and some of his customers. He allowed me to show this internet plan and sold most of my CDs. I went back to my canopy, took all the CDs of all my teammates. I went to institutes like NIIT, Aptech, sold the whole stock of the day. Second day of my job, I was promoted to be the team leader. Now, I'm telling you this story because I have the habit of going into the root of things. And not just doing it for the sake of doing it, but I want to understand why is this thing being done, and what is the purpose of it. So I did many sales promotional jobs like this. I also worked at McDonald's, where I had to mop the floor, clean the loos, flip some burgers, whatever it needs to be done, I had to do it. So during this time, I was doing my graduation from Sri Aurobindo College. Evening, BCom pass, and in 3 years I attended only 3 classes. First year 2 classes, second year none, and last year 1 class. Every year I would write an undertaking that I'll be a good student and I'll attend all my classes. But again next year I would not do the same. I was always hustling and taking these part-time jobs and small jobs, whatever I could get my hands on to. So one of my uncle used to own a DJ console, something like this setup, and his DJ was not well, and he had a party next day and he needed a DJ. So he asked me, do you know anyone who can play the DJ? And I was like, when is the party? He's like, tomorrow night. I had 2 days. I was like, yeah, I can do that. He's like, do you even know about it? I was like, just let me try. So I took over the console for 2 days. I basically I had seen that guy playing, so I knew how to fade from one track to another. I practiced looping and few other techniques, fading. And I was ready to play for a party of 200 drunk people in Delhi and make them dance, which is probably, it's not that difficult. And also, I was up for new things. So I had nothing to lose and I had 2 things to gain: experience and 500 rupees. So basically, I did everything that I could in my life to earn money, except for one thing, which is tattooing. Now, during one of these parties, I saw one expatriate with a big tattoo on his arm, and I was around probably 20 at this time, 1920. And I saw this tattoo and I was mesmerized with it, fascinated with it. So I wanted to get it on myself. In fact, I wanted to do it because I could draw, so I wanted to know how is this being done. I wanted everything to do with it, basically get into the roots of it again. So I had little bit of money saved up, less than 10,000 rupees. So I had 2 options: either I can get a tattoo done, or I can buy the machine and get unlimited number of tattoos on myself. No surprises, I chose the latter. And when I bought the machine, I did not even have the money to buy the whole equipment. So I went to the Lal Killa electronics market to buy the power supply, went to a local electrician to get the makeshift foot pedal made. I had just had the machine, the needles and the inks. Everything else was improvised on the spot. And that's how I started tattooing. And the next problem was I did not know how to tattoo. So I figured out that someone must have invented all these systems, from the scratch. The inks, the needles, the machines. All I have to do is just, everything is in front of me. I have to assemble it and learn how to use it. So I taught myself how to tattoo. There was no YouTube tutorials that time. I'm talking about 2003 when I started. There was no YouTube tutorials. There was no, not even Google also, I think did not exist. Yahoo and all these chats used to be there, but basically no information how to tattoo. So I was trying to do something on my leg, but I was scared. So my father told me, do it on myself. So that is the level of support that I had. So I did my first tattoo on my father, and he was completely cool and calm with it. I was losing my nerves, and I was very scared. And he was like, yeah, go ahead. And with every prick, I used to ask him, is it hurting? And he used to be like, no, go ahead. So that's how I did my first tattoo. And the second one I did on my own, and I got a little bit of confidence. In fact, my sister was in the same room, and I could not reach this because I cannot see from front, so I could not reach this part. So I just casually handed over the machine to her and asked her to tattoo this area, and she just did that. So we were crazy kids like that who did not think twice about doing something new, and we just dove first, you know, into anything new. And this is how I started tattooing, but this was not a profession still. At this time, I had completed my graduation. I had started doing my PG, which is equivalent to an MBA from Wigan and Lay College, UK. And I used to go to the college full time, 8 to 12 in the morning. From 12:30 to 6:30, I used to work in a corporate. In the night, after my corporate job, I used to play the DJ whenever there used to be a gig. In the weekends, I used to tattoo. So I was juggling between four things in a row. Every day, four things I had to do. And that time, I did not know what to do. I wanted to leave my job, but my parents were still apprehensive. So I rented out a small space, 8 by 8 feet space, in a salon in Vasant Vihar. And just on the weekends, I started working there. And they were, fortunately for me, I had the first mover's advantage. There were not many, probably one tattoo studio in Delhi. That guy also used to go to Goa or come to Delhi sometimes. So no permanent tattoo studios here. So I took a small space, started working, and also I studying at the same time, doing my corporate job. And whenever there's an appointment on the weekdays, I'll call in sick and I'll do the tattoo. So because I was more interested in this. And just by working on the weekends, I started earning four times more money than my corporate job. So I told my parents I'm leaving my corporate job, and they were again apprehensive. Like, my father has spent half of his lifetime savings on my MBA, the course PG. So he was like, you know, this is not a, tattooing was not an occupation that time. You have to understand this in India. Tattoo artist, it was not a profession. So he told me that no one will get a tattoo every day. You might get few tattoos nowadays, you know, but if someone comes in today, he will not come next month or even next year. So this is not a profession. And a lot of people told me that. So I said, well enough, let me try. I kept on trying, and for consistently 1 year, I gave him this same result, four times of my salary I used to give him. And then after 1 year, they were also convinced. And that's how I left my permanent job and started doing tattooing full time. My girlfriend at that time used to buy two movie tickets mostly on Sundays, because that was the only day we used to meet. And she used to go to the movies alone after that, because my tattoo would still not be finished. So that was the level of support I had from her, and that is why she is my wife now. It's been 18 years, and she still inspires me till this day. Even if I'm feeling down or low, or, you know, she's the one pushing me forward. Some of my best work comes out when she pushes me to do something better. Otherwise, I'm very lazy, and the first TED talk that we saw, procrastination, and the panic monster. So that thing happens, but my wife is the one who's pushing me a lot and doing everything. So that's how I started, and in Vasant Vihar, from a small 8 by 8 feet space, I used to do 5 tattoos in a month, 5, 6, 7. But tattoos were still expensive that time. So I used to, and in my corporate job, I used to get 7,000-8,000 rupees. Here I was making around 30. So I was very happy, and then people started to know more about this guy who does tattoos here. So it started snowballing very organically. There was no Google ads or anything like of that sort. It started to grow automatically. A lot of people wanted tattoos, and a lot of youngsters wanted to learn it also. So I, from once alone, me alone in the studio, the team grew to 20 people over the years. From 5 tattoos in a month. Now we do around 500, 600 in a month. And along the way came a lot of achievements like the Guinness record, or I was the first artist from Asia to be invited to the world's first tattooing university, which is in Italy. And they give you the degree in fine arts and tattooing. That's the world's first and only university. So I was a guest lecturer over there, teaching tattooing to children from all over the world. A lot of other achievements, awards in international conventions. I also organize India's first and biggest tattoo convention, which is like a trade fair. If you've never been to one, it's like a trade fair, but all the booths are occupied by tattoo artists. So I started doing this, and we never make a single penny out of it. We have spent a lot of money in this project because this is my way of giving back to the industry, which gave me everything. This convention, the motive behind organizing the tattoo convention, which is like a tattoo festival, is that no one just walks into a tattoo parlor. People are literally really apprehensive about, you know, walking into one. So if they come to the convention, they see other people getting tattooed. It's like a fair where there's music, food, tattooing happening. People get a little more comfortable with the idea of tattooing. So this was one of the ways I thought of paying back to the industry, which gave me everything. Now, first 5 years of my career, from 2003 I started, to 2005 I started full time. 5 years of my career, which are more than 1800 days, I did not take a single day off because I was passionate about it. I did not feel like I was working at all. I felt like I'm just drawing and I'm getting paid handsomely for it. So first 5 years, I did not, 1800 days, every day I was working. The only off that I took was when I married my then girlfriend, now wife. 2010, we took a 3 month off. We went off to Europe, so 3 month honeymoon. And she has been constant support. Now I'm telling you all this because people ask me, what is success for you? And how to become successful? For me, see, I always tell people, when we did not have anything, success is mostly a frame of mind for me. When we were small, we were young, we did not have many resources, we were still happy. And now when we have everything, and by the way, that house that I dreamt of, I bought that. And in fact, I bought a few of those. So everything went well. And monetarily, people think success is measured in money terms, but I won't get into the monetary part. But it is mostly with the lack of resources, I was ready to do whatever I wanted to do. And I'm very thankful to take all the shots that life threw at me. I took all the shots. I did not miss any opportunity. And that is why I always advise people that don't regret anything that you have done and you have failed in. Never regret the things that you have done. Only regret the things that you have not. Thank you.